Okay, thanks. So the title of the talk is Does Music Make You Smarter? And it might seem sort of needlessly sexy or provocative or something, that kind of title. But I'd like to claim that it's actually ground firmly in the issues of psychology. And one central theme in psychology is how our experiences change us. So for example, if you're in abnormal or clinical psychology, you might look at how early traumatic experiences then affect later personality development. If you're a social psychologist, you might look at how experience with some sort of minority group changes attitudes towards the minority group. And if you're a cognitive psychologist like me, two ways that we examine experience and change are priming and transfer. So the thing we call priming, that means exposure to a stimulus subsequently affects, usually positively, processing of the same stimulus or a related stimulus. And transfer refers to when learning in a domain subsequently either helps or hinders learning in a similar domain. So in other words, experience and change is central to all of psychology, and this is just one example. Okay, now the question of whether music makes you smarter is only going to be significant or important if musical experiences are somehow special. So for example, if smelling a rose or eating a piece of chocolate has exactly the same effects as listening to a piece of music, then the claim is more or less hollow. And similarly, if learning how to play soccer or swimming has exactly the same effects as taking music lessons, then again, the claim has no meaning. And finally, does exposure to music lead to non-musical benefits? This, of course, is crucial. So if you listen to music, even if you're not musically trained, you're going to learn about Western musical structure, about sort of what to expect, when a song's going to end, when the chorus is coming, that sort of thing. And if you actually take music lessons, you're going to learn about harmony and intervals and chords and things like that. But those are more or less obvious outcomes of exposure to music. The question I'm asking today is whether exposure to music leads to non-musical benefits. Okay, now exposure to music in our society typically takes two forms. So the first is music listening, which is ubiquitous. Everyone's a music listener. We hear music even when we don't want to hear music. The other one is music lessons, which is actually, you know, skilled musical performance is actually the province of a relatively small minority in our culture. And I've argued in several papers that there's no reason to believe why any side effects of music listening should parallel in any way benefits of music lessons. So, and that these two topics should be treated separately. And so, in line with that, today I'm going to talk about intellectual benefits of music listening, followed by intellectual benefits of music lessons. And then to give you some sort of heads up, the answer for music listening will be yes, I get the effects in my lab, but no, I don't think they're special to music. And for intellectual benefits of music lessons, yes, but the reasons why we see those remain unknown. Okay, so let's start with music listening. Now, the origin of current interest in the notion that music makes you smarter began with this particular piece. That's a piece of music by Mozart. And what happened in this particular experiment was that undergraduates came to the lab. These are University of California undergraduates. They came to a lab and they listened to Mozart. They listened to relaxation instructions or they sat in silence. Afterwards, they completed a spatial test. And performance turned out to be better for the Mozart group than for the other two groups. Hence, the effect was known as the Mozart effect. And this is the actual figure. It was published in Nature, so it got a lot of press. Nature is like the second most important journal in the world. And you can see here that, so the average IQ in the general population is 100. These are converted to IQ equivalents with a standard deviation of 15. So they're University of California undergraduates, so they're going to be smarter than average. But you can see that there's a difference between after listening to relaxation instructions or sitting in silence compared to after listening to Mozart. And it's about a half a standard deviation, which is a really huge effect. And I think part of the reason, I think that huge effect really sort of astounded people, and it made it really seem sort of unbelievable. And what also made it seem unbelievable, and I think actually sort of hindered further research in this area, was the explanation that was provided initially for the effect. So what the authors suggested was that really it's more or less a priming explanation. So that listening to Mozart then primes your brain or activates your brain in the same sort of patterns that are used when you are doing a spatial temporal test. So what do we know about priming and if we're a cognitive psychologist? Well, let's say that you're in an experiment in psychology and you're listening to headphones and you hear the word bread, and then subsequently you're asked to complete this word fragment. The likelihood of putting bread in there instead of blood or blonde or bleed or breed increases. Okay, so that's really sort of obvious. But also, if you hear bread and then you're asked to complete this, the likelihood of putting butter in there increases, even though better is a more common word in the English language. And if I say there are more rows than there are columns in this room, and then ask you to fill in this one, the likelihood of putting rows in there instead of road or rope increases. So we have lots of priming effects in psychology. So we have repetition priming, semantic priming, phonological priming. But in each case, the link between the priming stimulus and what's primed is really obvious. Okay, but in this particular explanation, what they're talking about is priming across unrelated domains. Now, you know what listening to Mozart sounds like, but you probably don't know what spatial temporal abilities are. So let's I'll tell you by way of an example. Okay, so this is a particular task. It comes from the Stanford-Binet paper folding and cutting task. So you have a piece of paper there. So these are paper folding manipulations. The paper is folded down, and it's folded across like this. And it's folded down like this. And I don't have scissors, but I'm going to rip it. Okay, now Isabel. You have to tell me now which one of those five unfolded pieces of paper correspond to what I have in my hand. I mean, you just learned Mozart, so you should be fabulous at this. No. No. B. Here's another one. Paper's folded down, it's folded across, it's folded down, it's cut out on those dark lines. That's what's left. What does it look like when you unfold it? Excuse me?
A.
No. No. This is part of your IQ. It's C, yes. I heard somebody say C, yes. Okay, now an alternative view that my colleagues and I have put forward is that the effect, the so-called Mozart effect, is actually a consequence of arousal and mood. In other words, music and any other stimulus that influences your arousal level, your mood, your level of enjoyment, will in turn influence how you perform intellectually. Now, the thing that's the advantage of this particular explanation is that both of these links are well established in the literature. Okay, so if you ask people why they listen to music, they tell you they listen to music because of the way it makes them feel. And if we also know from lots of research that performance on a test tends to be really good if you're not too sleepy and you're not too hyper, but your arousal level is approximately, you know, optimal somewhere in between, and that's called the Yerkes-Dodson law. It's a very well-established principle in psychology. We also know from Alice Eisen's lab at Cornell that if you have undergraduates come into the lab and you give them a little bag of candy and then you ask them to do a creativity or a problem-solving test, the undergraduates who got the bag of candy do better on it than the undergraduates who didn't. Okay, so that's the advantage of it. Now notice that this particular explanation here in this box, or the circle, I mean, it doesn't say anything about Mozart. So what we did in the very first experiment is that we attempted to replicate the Mozart effect, but we also went to the very next track on the exact same CD. So it had, this piece was performed by the same pianist, it had exactly the same recording quality, except it was a piece written by Schubert, and we found a Schubert effect. Okay, so participants completed the PF&C, so that stands for paper folding and cutting, the task that I demonstrated after they listened to music or sitting in, or they sat in silence. And the music was Mozart for half of them and Schubert for the other half. This is what the Schubert piece sounds like. Okay, so here you can see then that performance on the paper folding and cutting task for the people who heard Mozart was better after they listened to Mozart than after they sat in silence. And exactly the same effect, slightly larger in magnitude actually, in absolute terms, for the Schubert versus silence comparison. Okay, well now you might say, yeah, but you have undergraduates, they come into the lab, you make them sit in silence for 10 minutes, no wonder they do poorly on the test. So that you could claim that's not an appropriate control condition, and indeed you would be right. And so what would be a better control condition would be another auditory stimulus that's about as interesting as, say, listening to Mozart. So in the next experiment, what we did is we compared listening to Mozart with listening to a narrated story written by Stephen King, and now the effect disappeared. Okay, so participants completed the paper folding and cutting task after listening to music composed by Mozart or to a story written by Stephen King. It wasn't particularly scary. It sounded like this.
I remember Kitty telling me once that after diving into the hay, she felt fresh and new, like a baby.
Okay, here's the data. Here are the data. Flat as a pancake. We get null effects in psychology, but we very rarely get them quite this null. I also asked the subjects, though, whether they liked the Mozart better than the Stephen King or whether they liked the Stephen King better than the Mozart. Half of them preferred the Stephen King, and another half preferred the Mozart. And for those who preferred the Mozart, we found a Mozart effect. For those who preferred the Stephen King, we found a Stephen King effect. Now, if it's true, then, that it's how you feel that's driving the effect, then you should be able to pick pieces of music that make people feel really somber or sad, perhaps, and you lose the effect. So what we did in the next experiment was we took a piece that's commonly played at funerals, Albinoni's Adagio, and we found no Albinoni effect. So here, participants completed the paper folding and cutting task after listening to music or sitting in silence. The music was Mozart or Albinoni. The Albinoni piece you might recognize, this is it. Okay, and we also measured arousal, mood, and enjoyment to get more specifically at the theory that, about what we thought was happening. Now, here are the data. So you see then that there's a huge Mozart effect for the people who heard Mozart compared to sitting in silence. For Albinoni, it actually goes in the opposite direction, although this difference isn't significant. Okay, so we got a Mozart effect, but no Albinoni effect. And we also asked them about their differences in arousal, mood, or enjoyment. And when we held those constant, from the beginning to the end of listening to the Mozart piece, the Mozart effect disappeared. Okay, so now you might say, well, that Albinoni piece is such a cliche. Maybe somebody was just at a funeral and there was a grandmother or something. And, you should use something that, won't be so evocative, something that's more highly controlled. Well, fortunately, we know in music that there are some dimensions of music that control its emotional valence very directly, specifically the tempo and the mode of the piece. So in the next piece experiment, that's what we did, is we examined then whether it was the effects of tempo and mode which drive the emotional response, which would in turn then drive whether you see the advantage in cognition. So what we did here is we used MIDI versions of the exact same Mozart sonata you heard. So we had a pianist come into the lab and play it. And then we used MIDI then to make four different versions that were identical except for these dimensions which are known to influence emotion. So they were fast in major, fast in minor, slow in major, or slow in minor. Here's the fast major. And here's the slow minor. I'm just giving you the two most extreme ones. Okay, so what did we find? Well, we found exactly what we expected. So performance was better than for here, after the major key pieces, than after the minor key pieces, and for the fast tempo pieces, than for the slow tempo pieces. And the vast bulk of these differences in differences on the paper folding and cutting test could be accounted for by the way people were feeling. Okay, now if you go back to the model that I put forward, notice that in the third circle there it says intellectual performance. And so far I've only been talking about spatial abilities. and the reason why we use that spatial test is because the initial theory was specific to spatial abilities, but we don't think it has anything to do with that. So then we moved on to the next experiment to test adults with non-spatial abilities. Okay, so we had tests of processing speed or working memory. These were subtests from the Wechsler Adult Intelligence Scale. And the music was Mozart on one visit to the lab, Albinoni on the other visit. And we measured arousal and mood before and after the music listening. Here's the effect of the emotion variables. So here's a measure of arousal. It increases for Mozart, but decreases after hearing Albinoni. Here's a measure of sad mood. Sad mood goes up after hearing Albinoni, but down after hearing Mozart. Okay, so that's the mood effect. What about the cognition? Well, we got the effect we expected. So the blue bars then for Mozart then are higher. This is the processing speed task, and this is the working memory task. This difference wasn't actually significant, although this one was. So there may be some tasks that are more susceptible to mood than others, but as far as we can tell, it has nothing to do with spatial temporal abilities. Okay, so if it follows then that it's really how you feel that's driving the effect, then the particular type of music that's the most effective in this regard should depend on the particular group of listeners. So now imagine that you're an 11-year-old growing up in the UK. Would Mozart have the best effect for you? Or might it be something that sounds like this? Okay, that's a song by the British pop band Blur. It was a huge hit everywhere except in North America. And you can probably guess the title of the next slide, which is the Blur Effect. Okay, so we had over 8,000 British 10 and 11-year-olds from 150 schools listen to BBC radio, and then they completed the paper folding and cutting test. So the BBC recruited these schools to participate in a study of the so-called Mozart effect. And then they got way more schools wanting to participate than they actually expected. Okay, like in Canada, we know that there's more than one BBC. Okay, so on BBC3, so this is all sort of in collaboration with the BBC, they played Mozart, and this is on a Thursday morning at exactly the same time. So a third of the 10 and 11-year-olds at one school went to one room and heard BBC3. Another third went to a different room and heard BBC One. And another third went to a separate room and heard BBC Five, which is my collaborator, Susan Hallam, talk about the experiment. So where would you predict performance to be best? We expected, like according to our theory, that performance would be better after listening to Blur than after listening to Mozart or Science Talk. And that's exactly what we found. Okay, now pushing the point even further, now imagine that you're a 5-year-old growing up in Japan. What music is going to have... You were a 5-year-old growing up in Japan. What music would have make you perform better? Well, I might have something that would work for you. So the next slide is a children's play song effect. So what we did here is we looked at Japanese 5-year-olds, and we had either listening or singing. So remember, we don't think it's anything about listening to music per se. It's just something, it's an activity that puts you in a good mood, which then in turn affects a wide variety of human behaviors. And here we actually examined, here's the Japanese song. Sorry. You know this? Okay, here's another one. They're so cute, I always play two. Okay, so what we did was we actually looked at creativity in terms of drawing now. So each child then made a baseline drawing and a drawing after one of these musical experiences. And the dependent measures were how long they drew and the quality of their drawings. And you can see this is an increase in drawing from baseline. So everybody drew more the second time. What we did is we just gave them a single piece of paper and 18 crayons and said, do whatever you like. Okay, everybody drew longer the second time. For our purposes, it's important here that these two bars then are significantly higher than those two. So there were longer drawing times after listening or singing the familiar songs. And we also had independent raters judge the two drawings from each kid in terms of their creativity, their energy, and their technical proficiency. And here are the data. So these two bars here after familiar listening or familiar singing, they were judged on a scale from 1 to 6. So 3.5 then is the exact midpoint of the scale. And you can see that for each of the measures then after familiar listening or familiar singing, the creativity, energy, and technical proficiency ratings were higher than the mean, but they were lower than in other words, the music drawing got higher ratings. And for the Mozart and the Albinoni, then the drawing, the initial drawing, the baseline drawing got higher ratings. So just to give you a sense of what the task was like, so it was counterbalanced whether the drawing was on the left or the right. We had them rate on a 6-point scale how the right drawing compared with the left drawing. So here are two drawings from one child. The left, yeah. Well, that was a baseline drawing for a child who heard Albinoni later. And now this one? That was one a drawing from a child after listening to familiar children's songs, and this was his or her baseline drawing. Okay, so the conclusions then for the part one of the talk are that music affects arousal and mood, which in turn affect performance on intellectual tasks. Notice I put a question mark in there now, because I don't actually think that the findings that we're getting are qualitatively different from those that you see in other contexts. So in other words, how we feel really affects behavior in the broadest way. So we know then that people who go in for operations, if they take a CD that they like to listen to, they tend to need less pain medication afterwards. So in other words, I think that music and other stimuli that affect how you feel affect a behavior and experience in the most broad way. Moving on now to the second part. This is on music lessons now. So just to give you some background information. Okay, from correlational studies, we know that musical aptitude, or sort of what's kind of innate musical ability, we know that that's associated with virtually all other intellectual abilities. Other correlational studies show that music lessons are predictive of virtually all other intellectual abilities. And if you look at experimental studies, it seems that music lessons might cause improvements in reading, math, or spatial abilities, but typically the control condition involves no lessons of any kind. So it's really hard to determine whether those effects then are just the consequence of going to some training, some involvement with an adult, or something like that. So in an experiment, I tried to sort of rectify some of the problems with those other studies. So what we did was we put an ad in a paper for free arts lessons. Okay, so this is in a local paper, and we got lots and lots of responses, as you would expect. And then what we did is we picked 144 families. Each of them had a 6-year-old, and they were assigned randomly to weekly lessons for a year. And there were two music groups, either keyboard or voice lessons. The voice lessons were taught in the Kodai method. Or then there were two control groups, drama lessons, selected because they were taught in exactly the same location by teachers with the same qualifications, so that you can get an ARCT in music or in speech and drama. So all of the teachers then had ARCTs, Associate of the Royal Conservatory of Toronto. And notice that we had, when we selected the families, we interviewed them on the phone to make sure that they were going to participate regardless of the condition to which their kid would be assigned. So we tried to gauge the sincerity. And then we actually went to every single person's house and interviewed the parents, again, to sort of make sure that they were sincere about it. And because obviously you need a keyboard if you're going to be in the keyboard group, all of the families then had to have a keyboard at home with at least 4 octaves of full-size keys. Okay, because it wouldn't be a good experiment to stick families with keyboards into the keyboard group because they might differ systematically from other families. Okay, so that's the basic design. And all of the children were tested before and after the lesson. So this is before grade one in the summer, before grade one, and then in the summer between grades one and grade two. Okay, and we tested their entire IQ using a 2 or 3 hour Wechsler intelligence scale for children, their educational achievement as measured by a standardized American test of educational achievement, and their social skills. Okay, so these are the IQ data. Everybody increased from the first testing time to the second time. So here it says mean increase in full-scale IQ. We know that this is a common effect of schooling, so that just the mere act of going to school tends to raise IQs. But the important point here is that the red bars are significantly higher than the white bars. Okay, now there's lots of ideas out there in the literature and in sort of mostly in folklore, actually, not in really the literature, but of these special links, particularly music and math or music and spatial abilities or music and language. And the Wechsler test has 13 different subtests, and they load on 4 major dimensions or indexes. So here you have, this is verbal abilities, perceptual organization refers to spatial abilities, this is your ability to concentrate, and this is how fast you do a speeded task. And notice that in each case, then, the red bar is higher than the white bar. Okay, it may look like the difference then is higher for the fourth one, but if you know anything about statistics, the F for the interaction was actually less than 1. So there's absolutely nothing going on then. So the effects were very widespread, so there was no sign of any sort of specific link between taking the music lessons and some subset of intellectual abilities. Okay, the music groups also had larger improvements on a standardized test of educational achievement. That was the Kaufman test of educational achievement. We gave that because the Wechsler test is actually slightly different. It has different norms for Canadians. And of course, you want to publish in American journals. And Americans are so suspicious of everything Canadians do. So we gave them the Kaufman test of educational achievement and American test of educational achievement. I'm saying this directly to Ellen. Okay, only the drama group, interestingly enough, had improvement in adaptive social skills, which seems like a logical outcome, given that they had to rehearse and play sort of dramatic games with their other children. I forgot to say that all of the classes were taught in the same way, that is, in groups of 6, all at exactly the same location with teachers with the same backgrounds. Okay, now the next question people want to know, well, would you get bigger differences if you had even more music lessons? And unfortunately, you can't really study that experimentally because kids start to drop out. And they don't drop out the same across the different conditions. And the kids who drop out aren't going to be the same as the kids who stay in. So in that particular experiment that I just talked about, 6 of 36 kids dropped out of the keyboard group, 4 dropped out of the Kodai vocal group, 2 dropped out of the drama group, and nobody dropped out of the control group because they were all waiting for their music lessons the next year. So they were all sort of still wanting to behave well. Okay, so you can't really ask that question on any longer-term method, but you can do it correlationally, meaning that you can look at kids in the real world, see how many music lessons they have, how many years of lessons they have, or how many months, or more specifically, and then look at their IQs. And then you can try to hold constant alternative explanations of those links, like in particular family income and the parents' level of education. Okay, so we recruited almost 150 6 to 12-year-olds. We measured their entire IQ again. We got their school performance. So ever since Mike Harris was elected premier in Ontario, we have exactly the same report cards in every single school. Before that they varied, but in the conservative revolution they sort of made the school boards have exactly the same report cards. So that's good for science anyway, because now they're comparable. Okay, and preparents provided information about the child's history of music lessons, their family income, the parents' highest level of education, the other things the child did for outside of school, and the child's school performance as measured by a photocopy of their latest report card. And first of all, involvement in non-musical out-of-school activities was not associated with IQ. Okay, in truth, just to be a little more specific, there was an association between the duration of involvement in sports and IQ, except that was just a consequence of the fact that there are these sort of super parents that are driving these kids around to a million different activities. And when you held constant their involvement in music lessons, that effect disappeared. But that wasn't the case for music lessons. So in general, then, the longer the duration of music lessons, the higher the IQ, the better the performance in school, the higher the score on a test of educational achievement. So on all three of those measures, exactly the same thing, and these effect sizes were virtually identical. So it doesn't matter whether it's a one-to-one IQ test sort of testing situation where you're striving to get the child's best performance. It's also true in terms of their report cards and on that American standardized test. And in all cases, the simple correlation was 0.35. Maximum value is 1. It's not a huge number, but it's certainly respectable in terms of this kind of research. And after controlling for parents' education and family income and involvement in other activities, it went down, but it was still very significant in terms of the statistics. And another notable finding is that in each case, the association was strongest for the aggregate measure. So the link then was strongest for full-scale IQ, not any of the indexes, not any of the subtests. For the test of educational achievement, it was strongest for the average. For the school report card, it was strongest for the average, not for any sort of specific subject in school like math or like language. Okay, and once again, we found that music lessons were not associated with social skills. You guys are such good sports. Okay, so moving on to adults, would the effects linger on or last for a longer period of time? Here we looked at 150 first-year university students. And they provided information about their history of formal music lessons and playing music regularly, because we thought that, well, there's going to be a difference between somebody who took 2 years of lessons and then never touched the piano again and somebody else who took 2 years of lessons and then continued to play regularly for another 2 years. And when they actually did the statistics, it was playing music regularly that mattered more, although the same effects were evident for music lessons, just a little weaker. Okay, we asked them about their family income, their parents' education. We also remember these are all first-year Psych 100 students, so they're just out of high school. They knew what their academic average was, so we asked them about that, too, in high school. And on average, the more years they played music in childhood, the higher their IQ in adulthood, and the higher the high school average. Notice the effects are getting small. They're still significant, but just barely. So you get there's a long-lasting association, although it's quite weak. But it doesn't matter whether you look at just the simple association or you hold constant family income and parents' education. And again, the effects were general and strongest for the aggregate measure of IQ, the full-scale IQ, rather than any specific subtest or index. So now some outstanding questions at this point in the talk. Are music lessons associated with increases in G? Well, some people don't believe in G, but most psychologists do. G is like the sort of the innate sort of kernel of intelligence. It's very hard to modify and very stable across development. So the results that we're getting sort of look like that might be happening, yet we know that that's really an unlikely thing. An unlikely sort of outcome that music lessons would actually increase G. Another question, remember we're finding no relations between music lessons and social skills, so are the associations, the non-musical associations, strictly intellectual? So what about if you look at emotional intelligence, for example? And finally, how can we explain the association between music lessons and IQ? So in a psychology sense, you would say, well, what's the underlying mechanism that's driving the effect? But for people who don't have psychology backgrounds, it's just, well, what's really going on is the question there. Okay, so music lessons in G. Here we had just 40 adults, but they had either lots and lots of music lessons, so a mean of 11 years, or no music lessons at all. And we gave them Raven's Advanced Progressive Matrices, which is considered by most people to be the best measure of G. And also three pitch perception tasks, because in case there wasn't any difference on the matrices, you'd want to make sure that the groups were large enough and different enough to vary on tasks that you would expect to find differences on. So this is an example of a Raven's item. So you don't, you don't really need any instructions. It's pretty clear. You have to figure out what goes in the bottom right part of the matrix, and you have eight choices. Isabel?
Oh.
Robert? It's hard to do these under the glare of headlights.
Yeah. What do you have? I still don't
know.
You have to figure out which figure goes here. These are varying systematically. You have to figure out how they vary systematically, and then which one of those is the one that belongs in the missing box. It's five, yeah. Now what's happening here is that...
Yeah.
Well, what's going on is that if any... And it's the same rule whether you go across or down. If something is reduplicated... Okay, so those two, the V and the first two, it's there as you go across, it's there in both, so therefore it disappears. So in the second row there, only the horizontal bar is duplicated, so therefore it disappears from the third one. And here then, you have this part here is duplicated, so then what you want is what's left here and what's left there, so that's this, so it goes here. And it works exactly the same way if you go across. So this is supposed to be often considered to be the best measure of G. And what we found was that the musically trained group performed better on the pitch tasks, as you would expect, unless you took tones and put them way, way above the top notes on the piano, and then you lost the effect. But as long as the notes were in the musical range and you had pitch perception tasks, then the musically trained group was better. But there was no difference between groups on the Ravens. In fact, the untrained group had just slightly higher scores. So it doesn't seem like there's a consequence of a lack of power. Okay, now moving on to music lessons and emotional intelligence. Here we had 106 adults. They were again highly trained or absolutely no music lessons. And we gave them what's considered to be in the literature the best test of emotional intelligence, although there's quite a bit of debate about that, I would say. And we also gave them a different IQ test. So here are the IQ findings. This is like full-scale IQ, verbal IQ, nonverbal IQ. The trained people then are scoring higher on each aspect when you held constant whether or not their first language was English. The difference on the verbal IQ score disappeared, but it was still significant for the full-scale and for the nonverbal abilities. And what about the emotional intelligence? Well, this is the total score. This is sort of like full-scale emotional intelligence. These are the four main branches: perceiving emotions, facilitating emotions, understanding, and managing. And you can see that in some cases, the white bar is higher, and in other cases, the red bar is higher. The only difference then was on this one branch, and that's really sort of more or less like an emotional vocabulary test. So you're asking people, so if you feel this, and then this happens to you, what do you feel? So it's really like understanding the definitions of emotional words. And when you held constant whether or not English was their first language, that effect disappeared. So in other words, there was nothing. Okay, now finally, what's the role of executive function? Now there's some speculation in the literature that the association between music lessons and IQ is mediated by what we call executive function. Now executive function is a sort of messy, loose term that refers to sort of conscious control of thought. So how much you can focus, how you can be flexible, how creative you are, how can you avoid distracting information, how well you are at seeing ahead and problem solving, everything that's sort of like, working, sort of manipulating what's consciously in your mind. Okay, so the hypothesis then is that, that even though we have this association between music lessons and sonic cue, it's actually mediated or goes through there. Okay, so it should be the case then that if you administer then both these and these, and then look at them jointly, this association will disappear if you include this. Okay, so what did we do? Well, we had, and we're running this right now, we have 84 9 to 12 year olds as of today, and they are musically trained or untrained. And specifically, the 9 and 10 year olds have to have at least 2 years of lessons, that 11 and 12 year olds have to have at least 3 years of lessons. We gave them the Wechsler abbreviated scale of intelligence to measure IQ. And for executive function, we have 5 different measures. So these are the Wisconsin card sort. So that's a measure of how good you are at changing rules when they change, switching, task switching. Sun, moon, stroop, that's a sort of saying, in the first task, you see suns and moons, and you say sun, moon, 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 sun, sun, sun. And then in the second part, you have to say the exact opposite.
When you see the sun,
moon. Exactly. And when you see the moon, you say sun. And then it's the difference between those two, then, the decrement in performance that you look at. Verbal fluency was just saying as many words as you can that start with the letter F in a minute, the letter A in a minute, the letter S in a minute. The Tower of Annoy is like one of those discs on peg tasks. You have discs of different sizes. They're on the leftmost peg. And you have to put them in the same order on the rightmost peg. So, and there are 3 pegs. And there can be 3 rings or 4 rings. It's a very complicated and actually fun task to do. And finally, also a test of working memory, which was just hearing a list of numbers and repeating them either exactly the same way you heard them or in reverse order, which is called the digit span test. Okay, now the good news is that everything was associated with IQ, okay, which would have to be if that hypothesis were true. So you can see music lessons then had a quite large association, and in terms of the actual difference in IQ scores between the two groups, it's about 10 points. I mean, there's lots of variance though, but in terms of the average, it's about 10 points. Notice that the Tower of Hanoi has the highest association of all the measures, although it's very similar to especially music lessons, the verbal fluency, Tower of Hanoi, and working memory are all the same. But there were no associations between music lessons and any of the executive function measures, which means that the hypothesis can't possibly be true if these data are holed up. Now you might think, oh, well, you have a power problem. Well, we have 84 kids already. And this p-value is actually much, much higher for everything except digit span, which is actually part of IQ and IQ tests. The rest of the p-values are more around 0.5. Sorry to get too sciencey, but it just means that there's really nothing going on. Okay, so in terms of this model then, because this link then doesn't exist in the data, it more or less has to be wrong. And what seems from the data then is that what I would say the simplest explanation is that kids with higher IQs are doing more likely to take music lessons and more likely to do better on any task you give them. But it's also the case, remember, we found from the finding that music lessons do have a small effect on this, and it could be the case with executive function or IQ. It's more a question of which came first, the chicken or the egg, so it might be something like this. But there's no link here, as far as I can tell. Okay, so the conclusions from the second part of the talk, music lessons are associated with increases in IQ. That's quite clear from the data. The association is not attributable to extraneous variables that are associated with taking music lessons and with IQ. It's small, but it's long-lasting. It has applied relevance that extends beyond IQ to academic achievement, but not to social or to emotional abilities. And comparable non-musical activities do not have similar consequences, although they may have other good side effects, like the social consequences of drama lessons. Now, why is there this association then? Well, I think if you just ignore that one experiment from 2004, you could explain virtually all of the data by saying that kids with higher IQs are more likely to take music lessons. Like, virtually everything gets explained by that one little explanation. And the rule of parsimony in science means that you have to go with a simple explanation, all other things being equal. Okay, we know, however, that there was an effect then of music lessons on IQ, or that the arrow probably goes in both ways. My own view is that high-functioning kids tend to take music lessons, then music lessons exaggerate the advantage they started out with. So what about sort of why is there that exaggeration then? Well, it could be like an additional schooling effect. So music lessons might be a school-like activity that raises IQ a little bit more, just like school does. So we know that IQs tend to go down in the summer months. So especially if you're from a low SES family and you're not doing anything, you're just hanging around in the playground or parking lot or something, and then they bounce up. And we also know, I think in Quebec it's the same thing as Canada, you go, you're in one grade or another depending on whether you're born. Quebec and Ontario, I meant. Okay, we know you're in one grade if you're born before December 31st, and then the year behind if you're born in January. Right, and then so you have kids that are approximately the same age, but one group always has a year more, and those kids tend to have higher IQs. So it could be then that music lessons is an additional school-like activity that sort of boosts the effect of schooling, and then drama lessons wouldn't be sufficiently school-like from this perspective because they involve pretend and make-believe and things like that. Okay, it could be like learning a second language. So we know that bilingualism tends to confer some cognitive advantages, and Alan Bialystok at York is the sort of leading researcher in this area, although the effects that she finds are always limited to things like executive function. Right, so fluid intelligence, things that aren't about sort of knowledge that's sort of acquired and in your long-term memory. And the effects that I'm seeing then definitely involve sort of what you know, not what you can do on the fly. So even though that's appealing, it doesn't seem like the data really match up. One possibility is because there's so many different areas that you train in when you take music lessons. So learning to read music, learning to memorize pieces, fine motor skills, learning to express emotions, learning about learning to read a different system, et cetera, might then explain some of the why the association is so general. And it could be the abstract nature of music. I don't actually think this is what's going on, but it appeals to music people. So I say to you, okay, imagine Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, played on a piccolo very quickly. Okay, can you do that? So you can't do. Okay, now imagine Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star in your head, played on a tuba very slowly. Okay, so what is Twinkle, Twinkle? Well, you know, it's just about relations in pitch and time. So it's a complete abstraction. So there could be something about the abstract nature of music. I don't know, I just throw that out for to make music people happy, but I don't think anybody's buying it here. Okay, so the take-home message, now you can forget everything I said and just remember two things. One, like many other experiences, listening to music can change how you feel, and how you feel affects behavior, including intellectual functioning. And the other one, unlike other common out-of-school activities, music lessons are associated with small but broad intellectual benefits. Okay, I had lots of collaborators on these different studies, and of course I got funding from different sources. Before I stop, I want to leave you with a little excerpt from Kill Bill Volume 2, which really highlights some of the themes that I've been talking about.
Oh. What is your young man?
He owns a used record store here in Casa.
Ah, he's a clever, eh?
He's fond of music.
Aren't we all? And what are you doing for a J-O-B these days?
I work in the record store.
Ah, so. It all simply seems so clear. Do you like it?
Yeah, I like it a lot, smartass. I get to listen to music all day. talk about music all day. It's really cool. It's gonna be a great environment for my little girl to grow up.
As opposed to jetting around the world, killing human beings, and paying thousands of money.
Precisely.
Thanks.